Hi, this is José Luis here at Parametric Camp, and I would like to follow up on my previous video on this series, Advanced Grasshopper Development, where I would like to discuss why do we even want to bother doing development in Grasshopper? Why do we even want to bother writing code and creating our own plugins, our own, etc.? Why is that? Grasshopper is great, it's easy, it's introductory, etc. Why would we want to mess up with it and make our lives so difficult? Well, you probably know me already from other videos. The first thing I'm going to say is that, of course, we want to do that because we want power and because we want freedom. And customizing always leads us to those two things. But that's a little high level. Let's actually look into the details. What is Grasshopper? Grasshopper is so successful because it provides this model called visual programming, by which each operation that we want to do geometrically is represented by this thing called a component, which is a box that, where the metaphor that it provides to the user is, you only have to take care of what are you providing as an input, what is the data that the component needs to use to work, and we will give you the output, the result of the operation. But anything that happens inside, it's abstracted away from the user. The user doesn't have to take care of that. The user only needs to care about creating the tree of geometrical relations by dropping these components and correctly linking them with wires, which is a very nice metaphor for beginners, for people who are learning, and where it's already enough to have to deal with learning all the geometric implications of doing this, but it doesn't have the overhead of having to learn how to write computer code. So in this sense, Grasshopper is a fantastic tool as an introductory platform for people who have no experience in computational design and they want to learn algorithmic modeling. Now, for those users who are already very proficient in Grasshopper and they know how it works and they can really create amazing definitions, sometimes Grasshopper, you can hit the limitations of vanilla Grasshopper very easily. And some of those limitations are, for example, the fact that performance-wise, Grasshopper is actually pretty good, but it's not amazing. And it's not amazing because if you think about it, each component is a tiny program on its own. It has a bunch of code that works on translating the inputs from the outputs, but it also has a lot of other code, a lot of overhead about how to take inputs, how to take the outputs, convert them between native Grasshopper types and Rhino types, do the exchange between them, showing up on the screen with a particular icon, etc., etc. So that's why we have, by the fact that we have this modularity of components, it has a lot of overhead. So if instead of working with components that exchange data between them, we just have like a big fat component that does all the work, then performance-wise, it's actually much, much better. So we will see that in this playlist, in this series, very soon. On top of that, it could be argued that if you are reaching an expert level in Grasshopper, you may actually want to know what is going on behind the hood. Inside of the subdivide surface component, what is the code? What are the operations that are happening inside that are giving me all these points that are subdividing the surface into an equal grid of UV points? Because you are already at that expert level, right? So in that sense, Grasshopper, because it provides this black box model of not having to deal with code or not having to care about it, it's really good for beginners. But when you're an expert and you're actually asking yourself those questions, I ask myself those questions all the time, then it has the limitations that you can't really learn more or learn deeper what's going on by just using these components. You need to move on to writing your own or finding other sources, etc., etc. So it's not great for learning past the expert, the advanced level. Now, also, large definitions in Grasshopper can be really confusing. I don't know if you've ever heard the term Grasshopper spaghetti, but basically, I don't have an example right now, but when you write large Grasshopper definitions and then basically you see this like twine of wires connecting things with each other, it can get really messy. And you need to be really good at grouping things together with colors, giving them names, etc., so that things are legible. So there are many authors and many people who believe that large computer programs are much easier to read than large grasshopper definitions, just because computer programs are typically a line by line kind of situation. So you can read them this way, more or less. This is not entirely true, but you can read them sequentially and they're easier to understand for a human mind. Whereas here, because you're branching out so much and you have so many things interconnected, it's very difficult to keep a linear logic of the work, right? So large definitions can be tedious to understand, as opposed to perhaps large computer programs. And last but not least, there's the lack of customization problem. So with Vanilla Grasshopper, we can't really go fine-grained customizing many things, as for example, custom previews, automatic things baking onto the screen. There are like some things that we can't really do unless we access deeper functionality that is hidden from us. So in that sense, excuse me, in that sense, by using scripting within Grasshopper and by writing our own components, we can actually access all that power and we can overcome and like jump a level of expertise significantly within Grasshopper. And last but not least, if you want to share some kind of process, some kind of new functionality, some amazing geometric algorithm that you have defined, that you have designed, sharing it as a Grasshopper definition, it's typically not great. Grasshopper has some tools, like you can cluster things together and you can turn them into one component and you can password protect this so that people cannot access your source code if you are not interested in that. But it's a much more elegant, clean, and performative solution to, instead of doing that, just writing your own components, compiling them, and providing them as a plugin for other people to use. That is much cleaner, much better, and it's the standard way that people contribute to the Grasshopper ecosystem. And it's how people do research, write papers about Grasshopper, that components that they build, etc., etc. So in this series, we're going to delve deeper and take a look at what's going on inside of this component. And we're actually going to reproduce many popular components, like how do we make a point? How do we deconstruct a point? How do we subdivide a surface in UV points? We're definitely going to copy this component. It's very, very useful as a learning tool. And we're going to delve deeper about what's hiding inside components. What is the code that is written? How can we write our own components so that we can go past that advanced Grasshopper user level and we can be like really experts on how things work Grasshopper wise. All right, we're going to start by learning how to use scripting within Grasshopper. So I'm going to teach you how to write your own components inside of Grasshopper itself. And then once we have a good grasp of that, then we will transition to moving outside of Grasshopper, creating Grasshopper components in a development environment, AKA Visual Studio, and then how to compile them into native Grasshopper plugins that we can load in Grasshopper, okay? So if you're excited about learning how to do that, just stay with me, stay in this series, because then in the next video, we're going to start getting hands-on, all right? And in the meantime, if you like what you're seeing, then maybe consider liking this video, subscribing to the channel, saying hi on the chat, leaving a comment, you know, all those things that are common YouTube gratitude tokens, or however you say it. Anyway, thank you very much and see you in the next video, where we're going to start with the fundamentals of how to script inside of Grasshopper. Bye-bye.